today is 12th November 2020, and it's my pleasure to welcome Malene Møller Jørgensen. Malene has worked with the detection of EV since 2010 and developed the detection platform of EV array, which was published back in 2013. Since then, the use of the EV array in a clinical setting has been the motivation of her work, focusing on early diagnosis of lung cancer and SCLC. She is co-founder and coordinator of EV Search, Extracellular Vesicle Research Center Denmark, and also president of the Danish Society of EVs. She has been at the board of ISEF, members at large, in the period 2018 to 2020. So today, her talk is about potentials and capabilities of the EV array in health and disease. So please welcome Malene.
Super. And thank you for the short introduction, Carolina. Yeah, I have been working on the EV array for several years now. We, as you introduced, we have this Extracellular Vesicle Research Center in the northern part of Denmark. And we have several research groups, both at the hospital, but also at the university. And then more recently, last year, we founded this the DSEV, the Danish Society of Extracellular Vesicle, just to be a corresponding to the International Society of Extracellular Vesicles. So all cell types are producing vesicles in some kind. And we have all the studies show that if you put your cells into either hypoxia or normoxia, you activate them or you stimulate them, you give them drugs or so, then they will also affect the vesicles that they produce. And that's the reason why we also look as EVs as liquid biopsies, so that we in the bloodstream can detect these vesicles in hope to detect signs of disease in the bodies. So we actually see them as similar to the circulating tumor DNA or tumor cells and also DNA part. So as Caroline mentioned, we published this back in 2013 in the Journal of Extracellular Vesicles, where we proposed that we could capture extracellular vesicles onto a microarray platform and do a multiplexed phenotyping. The technology is based on microarray, and this is just a sketch of it, where we have small drops, approximately half a nanoliter of each. In these drops, we have antibodies that are targeting surface markers of the vesicles. Then we have samples, EV-containing samples. We could have plasma, urine, cell culture, supernatants. And then we apply these samples into the wells, and then we capture the extracellular vesicles, depending on which surface markers they are carrying. The detection part of this is done with a cocktail of biotinylated antibodies. It is against the normal one, the CD9, CD63, and CD81. That is the normal cocktail that we generally use, mainly because then we don't seem to rule anyone out of this, so that we don't have any selection of which types of vesicles that we are looking for. But then again, this is also a step that could be customized depending on which type of vesicles that you're looking more into. Then the last part of this is that we have streptavidine, Cy5 label of streptavidine that we put into this, which will then create this fluorescent staining that we can detect. This gives us a semi-quantitative measurement or phenotyping of the vesicles, so that we cannot say that it is the number of vesicles that we are measuring, but the amount of antigens being present on the vesicles. So a drawback of the method is that we cannot say whether it is one vesicle carrying 100 of the antigens or it is 100 of vesicles carrying one antigen each. In practice, we started out using glass slides, which is then printed. You see them here where we have an ID barcode on it, and then we have separated into 21 wells per slide. Putting these into this multi-well gasket format, we can then run it in a high throughput format. Here we have the quality control that we use ahead of the analysis. And down here we have an example on how the scanning of the fluorescence of the captured EVs will look like. We always do it in triplicates of each spot, just to make sure that if we have dust particles, etc., then we still have usable signals. And as you can see, the white here having a positive control in various degrees, and then we have negative control giving no signals. And then we have the markers being present on the EVs on the other ones. Then we have generated this second version of it, where we do it instead of using glass slide, we do it in the bottom of a normal multi-target plate or ELISA plate, where we have this array just printed into the bottom. It is much more easy to handle in the lab, and almost all laboratories have the standardized ELISA plate washer and that part. Also, it's not as sensitive to drying out, and you cannot just touch it as these glass slides are very sensitive to it. So this is the version that we are working on at the moment. We have tested the clinical robustness of our EV array. As we are part of a hospital, we know that if a analysis should go into the clinic, then we need to make sure that that there's not too many restriction on the samples that we apply to it, because then the doctor cannot draw this blood himself. You need to go to a specialized lab, etc. So we tested the various pre-analytical treatments of the plasma. So we started out with four different tubes of collecting the plasma. Then we will see whether we should, how long should the incubation be ahead of the centrifugation. We tested several centrifugation steps, several freeze-thaw cycle. We also mimic a kind of a transportation, because normally blood samples are transported from the local doctors to the hospital or to the laboratory. We also tested several storage conditions and also some few isolation methods. I will not share all the results of this study. It is quite comprehensive. But what we saw is that we could actually use pretty much all of these methods of collection of samples. But we were also very clear that when you have samples that you would like to compare, you really need to make sure that they have been collected and stored in the same way. So I think that is just the general conclusion, and also what other people have seen, that it is really important that that what you want to compare is also comparable. Then we tested the clinical relevant body fluids that we were that we had could obtain. So we started out, of course, with the plasma and serum being the main part, but also tested the urine and ascites, the bone marrow liquid, also the ball fluid, the sputum and synovial fluid. And when we did that, we saw that there is a great variation in the number of EVs, or not the numbers, but the signals that we could obtain from the various samples. So what we just try to illustrate here is that we have, for urine, we had three different donors. We could clearly see markers of the CD9 and CD81, but we also needed to load pretty much volume into our array relating to, for instance, plasma, where we have really high signals using only 10 microliters. But what we also saw is that the saliva part, we should actually be loading even more than this 50 microliters that we have tested of it. But we saw also that the bone marrow is really high, dense in the vesicle contents of it. So the aim of all of these study is that if we want to use these EVs in a clinical setting, it is also really important to know whether the characteristics of the EVs in a healthy cohort are depending on, so to say, the demographic parameters, such as age, gender, their smoking, so that you know what you should actually compare your disease cohorts to. So we did this study here where we tried to investigate whether the smoking, age, and gender does affect the protein phenotyping of these vesicles. And we had a cohort of 160 individuals, male, females, only above 40 years of age and up to 70 in age. And then we divided them into the groups of smoking and non-smoking. And this is a very comprehensive heat map of the results of this study. So the yellow color indicates no signal, and the red color indicates the high signals. And then we here have the 37 different markers that we tested simultaneously in the EV array. We did this heat mapping and try also to focus on which group of age the individuals were in, the smoking stages and their sex. And then we tried to color it relating to all of that part. And as you can see, there are no obvious patterns in all of this, indicating that some have more than others, and also that with the effects to age, etc. But if we go further into it and look into which markers are changing in relation to the smoking part, then we saw that looking for all the individuals, we had that the CD9 is actually increasing together with the CD151, whereas the EpCAM is actually decreasing in the smoking part. If we then split them up into the male down here, and we have the female up here, we then actually see that there are no significant of these antigens present here. We have no significant changes within the male cohort effects of the smoking. But if we look it into the females, then we see that we have several of them that are really decreasing in the smoking population relating to the non-smokers. So, and if we look similar into the markers that we saw changing in relation to age, we have this Amfictu regulin, where if we saw it for all the individuals, we saw a tendency that the protein load of this antigen is decreasing with age up to the age 69. We saw no relation in the myosin 1 part, but splitting then up into the female and male part again, we saw that this tendency is also present in the female, but it is only significantly a decrease in the male population. Then we did another study with the NIH and the National Institute of Aging, where we were a part of this HANDLES longitudinal study, where we had, it is a study planned for more than 20 years, but we have a cohort for the same persons within 5 years. And what they were seeing was that this is the NTA analysis of it, where we have the diameter here, and then we have separated the cohorts into the young part, the middle part, and the old part. And as you quite clearly see here, the young ones tend to have a higher number of particles in the plasma. We can then do the plotting of all of this, and then we see a nice statistical correlation here. This was not found when we are looking. It is slightly significant looking at the BMI of these particles. And then it was also tended to see whether there are, with the nanotracking analysis, that we could see differences with relation to sex or the race. There was no significant changes, but there were slight, there is a change in the second visit that they had after 5 years that we saw that they are relating to the smoker and non-smoker part. Then we have also a significant change in that number of particles that are present in the plasma stream. Then it was asked whether which cell takes up the vesicles in the bloodstream. Plasma from 74 donors. For that, they are isolated by ExoQuick. They isolated the vesicles. They were performed a membrane staining with the PKH27, use a size column and NTA to number all of the isolated vesicles. Then these vesicles were put into a PBMC pool from 5 different donors. And these this PBMC pool were then incubated for 24 hours before FX analysis were performed, with all of these markers having the one for the vesicles and then for several different of the PBMC's markers. So what we see here is that we have the negative controls and where we have the EVs, and we clearly see that for the monocytes, we see that they are actually taking up a lot of the vesicles, also for the B cells and a fewer for the T cells. Putting that into a graph, we clearly see that it is the monocytes that take up the most of the vesicles being present. And then secondly, it is the B cells, and it's only small amounts taken up by the T cells, both the CD8 and the CD4 T cells. This study was then continued to see the EV uptake by the B cells. It is quite a similar setup where we have isolated EVs from 62 donors. They're stained and then put into the PBMC pool of 4 donors. These donors were either a recipient, a part were either in the old one or a young one. We have then 2 old ones and 2 young ones. And then we did this flow analysis. And this is the part from the B cells and how many percentage of the vesicles that are they are taking up. At this axis, we have the age of the donors. And what we actually see here is that we have a slightly increase with relation to age, not depending on whether the recipient cells are from a young donor or an old donor, but more than EVs from older individuals are actually more readily internalized by the B cells. So it is kind of a that the older you get, the more I would suggest effective the EVs are to be taken up by the B cells. So conclusion of this study, where we have looked only on healthy individuals, is that the level or the numbers of EVs in plasma, they are actually decreased with advancing age. And also that it is the EV concentration is positively associated with the BMI and the smoking. We then have age, smoking, and gender. They actually have an influence on some of these protein characteristics. And that also this part that the EVs from the older individuals were more readily internalized by the B cells. Okay, then we have performed a number of lung cancer studies. And the reason why this is so interesting is that it is actually the that lung cancer accounts for the more death of each year than other types of cancers in comparison. And also that the 5-year survival rate for this non-small lung cancer is currently 11 to 18%. So many of the patients are actually in a very advanced stage when they are detected. So that is why we also need to be better to diagnose it. And this project we have performed with the Aarhus University Hospital and Aarhus University, which is also placed in Denmark. And it was published back in 2015, the first of it. We did this analysis with 2 groups. We had the lung cancer group, the non-small cell lung cancer group, just more than 100 patients. And we then have a control group. And this control group is actually a very good control group because it is not healthy individuals as the previous study, but it is the patients that come into the clinic with symptoms of lung cancer. It could also be the COPD, it could be the pneumonia, anything else, but it was not lung cancer or that. Then we did the EV array analysis on 37 markers. And we found that it is not possible to just look into one marker or 2 markers. We needed to do a multivariate data analysis to be able to see differences in the patterns of all of these patients, and we found a 30 marker model where we could actually achieve an accuracy of 75%. And we tested also how many variables that we should have, and we see here the red curve having only 3 variables, and we then could increase it a bit more, going up to 30 markers. So it is also a weightening of how many markers should you apply onto your array. The heat map of these results behind the ROC curve is actually that we up here see the control group in this part, the A part, and then we have the cancer group. And just taking an overview look of it, it actually seems that the control group are more red, so that indicating that they are actually having a higher number of antigens present on there. On the EVs, and that is actually a tendency that we normally have seen when comparing various diseases and healthy, is that the EVs aren't the bad guys all the time. It actually, you need them, and the more EVs you have, the more healthier you probably are. But of course, that depends on whether you are looking on one specific marker or a general view of it. Then the second part of this project, the first part was only made for the late stages of the lung cancer. Then we were curious to see whether we could detect it in the earlier stage of the cancer as well, and also for various groups of lung cancer. So we had included in this study 431 patients with various stages of the lung cancer, but also various types, where we have the adenocarcinoma, we have the squamous cell, and the small cell lung cancer. And then we had 150 patient with these lung cancer symptoms, but not having this lung cancer in the end. We have published two studies here, one looking at the diagnostic biomarker part, but also looking into the prognostic of whether we can use the EVs in that respect. These are the heat map for the diagnostic part, where we have all the EV markers up here, and we have all the individuals down here. And also we then had to see whether which states they are in, the histology of it, the age, etc. And once more, we just have to confirm that we actually need to do it in a multivariate way to be able to see a complex pattern in all of these heat maps. So starting out with the diagnostic part, we've actually pulled all the cancer patient in one cohort. And then we actually found that this marker, the CD151 and the CD171, is the one being best able to separate the groups. As you see, the non-cancerous part here, and then we have the cancerous part here. Then again, this one looks opposite of what I said before, that the control, the healthy, has more vesicles, but here we have actually taken into consideration the total number of signals, or the signals that we have on the CD9 and CD81 in general. So this is kind of a calculated the opposite array around, not just being the total signal, but the total signal in relation to the number of vesicles being present. If we have the ROC curves here, trying to do the multiplex analysis, then we thought that having a clinical model using 30 different markers is very difficult. So we decided to go for the top 10 of the markers that were most influenced these ROC curves. And then we did the analysis of having all the cancers. We had the adenocarcinoma, we have the squamous cell, and we have the small cell lung cancerous part. And we did all of these ROC curve gaining approximately a AOC of 0.75 in all of these, indicating pretty much the same level that we could separate them with. This graph down here is indicating which markers have the most importance to the graphic part. And if you see this one, the CD151, it is the one being most important to this model. It is also from this one and this one and this one. So this is actually a quite quite good marker of the lung cancer part. Then we have also the T-span 8, and then the markers start to switch a bit, which one should be the most important one to all the modeling of all of these data. Then we just short the conclusion of this, of the diagnostic part, is that we see that we can use this EB profiling. And we found that these three markers, the CD151, the T-span 8, and the CD171, is highly expressed, and we actually want to compare those to the patients without the cancer, and that we can use this multi-marker models, but also that we really need to have a larger cohort, both to be able to validate these promising biomarkers. Then we have the prognostic use of the EVs. We did that in two different ways, so that each marker was dichotomized based on its detection or not detection. And then we also did it for each marker of the overall survival. And we estimated both in a univariate way, but also in a multivariate analysis. And of course, where we adjusted for all the clinical pathological characteristics. So the results of the dichotomized part being absent or present in the bloodstream, we had these numbers, where we have the CD171 once more having a hazard ratio of 0.5. And after bootstrapping, implicating the stability of all of the model, we have found these four markers being significant within predicting having a prognostic value of all of this. And if we're looking into the survival curves of this, we have the example here from the CD171. We have the survival curves of the blue one indicating that you have positive EVs, you have EVs with CD171 in your bloodstream, and the yellow one without. We see a clear distinguishing on the mortality rate, so that actually we have a median survival that is more than 9.5 months of patients carrying this molecule on the EVs. So once more, some EVs are actually the good guys. Then we did similar with the overall survival, where we looked at the concentration of the antigens being present. And here I just exemplified the EGF receptor part with a hazard ratio of 4.4, which actually indicating that if you have a really high amount of vesicles carrying the EGF receptor in your bloodstream, you have a lower mortality rate, a 4.4 times lower than the one with the lower amount in the bloodstream. And this is actually quite exciting, as the chemotherapy that many lung cancer patients are gaining is targeting the EGF receptors in general, either the EGF receptor, the HER2 or HER3 part of that. So this could be a really good prognostic marker on their survival. So the conclusion of this prognostic part is that that revealed that we have these nine markers that are actually potential impact on the overall survival. And this is then also independent on all the known clinical and pathological factors. But again, it also needs to be validated in an independent cohort. Then continuing with lung diseases, I have made that kind of a theme of this talk. We have some German collaborators where we have been put into this study, where we have investigated the surface proteome in biomarkers for pneumonia and acute exacerbation of the COPD. We published that in the Journal of Infectious Diseases. And the background for this study is that we have the CAP and the COPD, CAP being the community-acquired pneumonia, which is quite a significant cause of morbidity and mortality in a worldwide. We all know it. It is the diagnose with the symptoms, cough, fever, etc. And then And then we also have, that is a microbial cause of it. But then again, these microbial is actually unidentified in many of the cases. And then we have, compared to that, we have the COPD, which is also highly prevalent in a non-communicable disease. It is characteristic as a chronic airway inflammation, and it is, of course, the main cause of it is smoking. Within the COPD, we then have these acute exacerbations, which are phases of a acute clinical worsening of it, and which is actually also often occur in combination with respiratory infections. So these acute exacerbation, they increase the short-term and long-term mortality risks, and they are also the ones that often require hospitalization. So if we compare, these are the alveoles from the healthy, the CAP patients and the COPD patients, we see that they are actually quite different how they are affecting the alveolia. And then we should be aware that both for having a COPD as a patient, you can both have either the pneumonia on top of that, or you can have the acute exacerbations. But it is quite important to be able to distinguish these two phases, that they must be treated differently. So it would be nice if we could find some biomarkers here. So we had a smaller cohort here. We have three groups. We have a group of healthy individuals, group with pneumonia, and one with COPD. We used the blood plasma, and this time we used it as EDTA plasma. The EV array panel that we used in this study, we had actually divided into four different kind of groups. We have the general vesicle markers, and then we have some general immune and inflammation markers. We had also one specific from the lung tissue, and then just have a group of other part of it. And if we compare these groups, we have the healthy versus the pneumonia group, and we see that the marker CD16 and CD45 is actually quite good at distinguishing these groups. But also if we have the pneumonia group and we have versus the COPD group, we have the CD45 also being really good at distinguishing these two groups. Then there are also kind of a whether you have an uncomplicated or a severe pneumonia. And this group we then had were able to divide that. And if we look at the results here, we see that the severity of the pneumonia part, you could actually see that in using just the number or the normal EV markers, the CD81 as a marker for the severity of your disease. Whereas the CD106 is actually kind of a decreasing in relation to that part. So yeah, but none of the markers were actually alone, were not able to gain an AUC that could indicate a diagnostic potential, but we see some very clear tendencies. Then just to make it even more complex, then we have these COPD patients, and we also have some with acute sample from a state where they have the acute exacerbation. And then we also have the pneumonia part of the patient, which were also some were just with pneumonia and some were the COPD patients with the pneumonia. And if we try to see that and comparing these patients with or without the pneumonia part, we clearly here see that some of these markers are high when you just have the acute exacerbation in relation to the one where you just have the COPD and the COPD with the CAP part. So just to make a quite long story short, then we could ask the question, does the patient have the acute exacerbation or COPD with a pneumonia on top of that? And we could actually distinguish that quite good with all of these markers. And it is the general immune inflammation markers that were tended to be seen with great differences in this study. So conclusively, in this study, we could see that analyzing the plasma, the extracellular vesicles there, it differs in patient with the pneumonia or the acute COPD. And it differs from the healthy controls using CD16, CD28, CD41, etc. And then we also had found that 24 proteins were differently expressed in the vesicles from the CAP patients. They were all kind of a membrane origin, of course, looking for the surface markers, and they were mainly downregulated of it. And then we found that the CD16 and the CD45 is best suited for discriminating between CAP patients or healthy controls. And we actually had a ROC curve and an AOC value of more than 0.9 of that. So this should be the final slide of my talk. And then, as you can see, we have a lot of collaborators in all of our studies, and I would like to acknowledge all of them. And then again, thank you for your attention. And if you want to find more information about the EV array, we have a homepage here on the evarray.dk. So yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much, Malene. So everybody can ask the questions in the chat box, please. And then you can unmute and ask your questions whenever I ask you. So how using this technology, clearly there are some technologies now where you can look at single vesicles, and it's emerging right now. How do you see these two types of approaches complementing each other, or where do they have their respective places in research primarily? That's what we're doing, right? But eventually also for diagnostics.
I see a great potential in all the technologies where you look at the individual markers or the individual vesicles having the markers. But what we also see is that it is really demanding on high-tech equipment to do that. So in a research perspective, that will give us so much more information. But I also see it very difficult taking that into the clinic and use it as a diagnostic part of it, because the clinical analysis should be, I wouldn't say more simple, but it should be more and kind of all over technology that you could use of that.
I think the Exocure team are planning to become a diagnostic company eventually. So, but I think that equipment is a bit slow. You need to incubate for some time and so on. But a cheap and simple technology that can look at single vesicles would be really, really interesting. Any questions? Put them in the chat. I don't see any questions so far, but I'll keep at it, and Carolina will compliment me as well. Carolina, you have something right now?
Just a few questions, I guess. So how long is that, the whole process of the analysis that you do until you get the result? Is it like hours, a matter of hours or something?
Yeah, no, it's not a matter of hours. Actually, we have an overnight incubation, but that is the main part of it. So it is a two-day analysis. But then again, we have also performed it on a shorter run. But having a normal working day, you can either choose to have a really long day or have it more separated on that. So I would say we can do it within 6 to 8 hours, but normally we have this overnight incubation just to make it fit more into the working hours of a day.
So I have a little try with ExoQuick, and sometimes the palette that I've got is really sticky. Do you find that as well in the lab, and whether you do some tricks to make it work for your array? Because I thought it won't work.
I would say using ExoQuick, you sometimes get something sticky and all of that. But then again, we use so few microliters of it so that we do it in a dilution part, and then we can actually dissolve all of that sticky part. And also, it is an advance for us that we are using antibodies to capture. because then we have all the remains of the PED in the solution, then it doesn't matter that we can just wash it away afterwards.
So we have a question from Kiyotoka Sensei. Could you please unmute yourself and ask the question?
Thank you very much. So I was interested in your data showing old people decrease the number of the particle in plasma. So in that case, how did you measure the particle numbers? So did it contain the particle from the platelet?
It wasn't my lab that performed that test. It was our collaborators at the NIH, but they did the normal NTA analysis of it. So I would say that they put, to my knowledge, they have not removed the EVs from the platelet. They have not worked entirely on platelet-free plasma, but just on platelet-poor plasma.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much.
I see, yeah. Yeah, so of course, a lot of the particles in circulation are coming from platelets, but also from, you know, lipoparticles, lipoproteins, and so on. Yeah. So how do you see that as a, is that competing for your assays or how does it work?
No, I don't see it as competing on that. Again, it is, we must say it is an advantage just to work with antigen antibody capturing, because then we don't capture all the lipid particles that are present there in the same degree, in the same way as you see it using the NTA or the CETA viewer, where you have all of these particles and you need to stain them to make sure that you don't just see protein aggregates on that.
Yeah, we had a sandwich ELISA being developed in our lab by Suchil Zhang, who's now at Kodiak, where he used two different mitochondrial inner membrane surface molecules to measure in plasma. It worked actually reasonably well, you know, so it's definitely possible. So one other thing that I noticed was that when you look at inflammatory diseases, a lot of your markers for EVs is also inflammatory cell associated, right? CD45 and so on. So, and then, you know, as a inflammation researcher and respiratory researcher that I am, you ask yourself, are we going over the river to pick up the water, or can we just as well count the inflammatory cells? That's what I'm thinking as a clinician.
Actually, I think we can do that a long time ahead also, because if we just look for the needle in haystack, the cancer EVs, it's not sure that we're going to find that. But just looking into a diagnostic perspective, I don't care whether it is the cancer EV that gives me the signal or whether it is the immune system's response to the cancer, for instance, that we are measuring, as long as we have the differences in that. Of course, as a researcher, I would like that we can say this one comes from a cancer and that is what we are measuring. But as a clear clinical diagnostic part, it wouldn't matter whether it is the response to the cancer that we're measuring instead of it. So I think we should look much more into the inflammation markers in many of the diseases as well.
So if you take the step, if you take two or three steps back and just think about inflammatory cells, and for example, a lymph node or a spleen, you have a massive amount of different inflammatory cells and you have vesicles there. Can you, by looking at the vesicles, distinguish which donor cell it comes from, do you think?
In some way, we will be able to do that. But I'm not sure that we can say this particular cell. But of course, we know that, for instance, you have the T cells that not many other cells are carrying the CD4 molecule. So that's a marker for the T cells. So if you find that on a vesicle, then I say this one origin for a T cell. But then again, we also made a study previously with isolating all of the different immune cells and having them in culture, measuring their vesicles. And it was really much different. What we found using flow cytometry on the markers that were carrying on the cell, we didn't always find that carrying on the vesicle. So it is not just small copies of the mother cell, it is actually some kind of intelligent packaging that the cells are sending around. So I'm not sure that I'm not sure that we can always say which cell this one will originate from.
No, I agree. I was also curious to hear that you saw a lot of vesicles in bone marrow. And of course, the classical papers from 83, from Rose Johnston and Phil Stahl, where they looked at reticulocytes and expelling the transferrin receptor through exosomes. And clearly that's happening in the bone marrow to a great extent. And when Rosella, she's not here today, but when Rosella in my lab, Rosella Cascitelli, took a little bit of bone marrow and sectioned it and looked for cells and vesicles, DDM, she saw a massive amount of EVs.
Yeah.
I mean, it was almost difficult to find a cell, but whereas you could see a lot of vesicles. So, but the question is, are those mostly from the red blood cells or from the reticulocytes? That's the question. What do you think?
I don't know. I must say the bone marrow is not my area of expertise. That is where all our collaborators come in with that. But as I do agree that it is, we were surprised of the really high number of vesicles being present. Even I would say 10 times more than in the normal plasma stream.
If not more than that, I think it's huge actually. All right, thank you very much, Malene. Stay on board. I'm handing over to Carolina to finish the session and to invite everybody for the next meeting.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Malene, for great presentations and also showing us your EV array, how we can utilize them for diagnostic and also prognostic marker.